value chain analysis of a company's cost competitive advantage requires to identify cost drivers, that is, the causes or origins behind primary and support activities cost differentials. Let's consider the main cost drivers. First of all, we can analyze the level of saturation of production capacity of what is called the technology and organizational configuration of the company. The underlying idea is that every company defines the technology and organizational method it will use to plan, develop, and coordinate those activities needed to put products on the market. These methods are called technology and organizational configuration. Within this configuration, each function and activity can be carried out by using assets or facilities, which can be represented by a plant, a machine, or even an information system. The asset is planned and sized on the basis of the so-called target capacity, that is, the yearly output capacity enabling the company to use production factors in the most efficient way possible. So, if the actual production is set at the target capacity, such production capacity is saturated, and the average cost per unit is minimum. However, whenever we produce less than the asset's target capacity, undersaturation may occur. In undersaturation, fixed costs like firm infrastructure and fixed assets cannot be spread on the maximum possible volume, so average cost per unit increases. To give an example, should fixed cost be $1 million per year and target capacity 1 million units or transactions per year, by placing our actual production at target capacity, we would spread fixed costs and obtain an impact of $1 per unit produced or transaction performed. If undersaturation occurs and actual production is 800,000 units per year, fixed cost impact on a single unit or transaction is $1.25, and average cost per unit increases. Conversely, in oversaturation, we have higher costs due to assets overstretch, waste, overtimes, and malfunctioning. These additional costs still determine an increase in average cost per unit. So, given that both over- or undersaturation conditions are suboptimal, why do they occur? The answer is in the complexity of real situations companies face. Undersaturation can be a consequence of a mistake in forecasting demand, leading to an oversizing of the production system. But it can also be a deliberate strategic choice the company makes in order to create surplus resources that raise entry barriers to the business area, thus preventing or reducing the threat posed by new entrants considered in the Five Forces model. Even oversaturation can stem from a mistake in forecasting demand, in this case leading to an undersized technology and organizational configuration. The asset can nevertheless get oversaturated to face contingent events, like meeting an unplanned order by an important customer, whose strong bargaining power can force the company to accept the order even though the costs are high. Let's now mention a second cost driver linked to the level of saturation. Let's talk about the so-called scale economies. The level of saturation has a short-term impact and concerns already functioning companies. We can expect that in the long term, a generic company constantly finding itself in under- or oversaturation will choose a different asset by selecting one with a target capacity that is designed to meet the real market demand. A consequence of this is the assumption that the same activity can be carried out with different infrastructural and organizational models of the activity itself, which means different technology and organizational configurations on the basis of the scale and volumes to be produced. The idea at the basis of scale economies is that scale and average cost per unit are inversely related. So when production volumes per year increase, the average cost per unit drops. This happens because in the long term, given a certain scale, the company can select the technology and organizational configuration that best suits that scale, aiming at reducing the average cost per unit and at improving performances. When the scale grows, the company takes advantage of a set of nonlinear events like the advantages of standardization, specialization of labor, and critical mass in order to design and create a more effective plant if compared to plants with lower scale. Naturally, adopting a bigger and better asset will require investments. Still, investments in an asset that is closer to the state of the art, both from a technological and an organizational point of view, is justified by an increase in the scale it has to produce. Just to consider a trivial example, if you need to produce one car per year, you can do that in your garage with basic technologies in a workshop fashion, since your scale does not justify additional investments. And that car will have a high cost per unit. But if you need to manufacture 1 million cars per year, such volume will justify an investment in automation, which represents another technological and organizational configuration with a much lower cost per unit. As a whole, the cost drivers of scale economies and saturation level have combined effects, since cost per unit of activities depend on both long-term choices of sizing the technology and organizational configuration on the basis of the scale for which the company was conceived, and on the actual level of saturation of the chosen plant in the short term.